All these results of my Leiden years owe a lot to an Indonesian circle of PhD students, the origins of which had already begun at the Free University. The students performed fieldwork among many other groups of Indonesia, and as early as 1988, the ethnographic findings of 17 of them had been combined in a kind of a coffee table book where they demonstrated how old local traditions get their expression in modern times. It is called Indonesia Apa Kabar. This is the book. Another prominent theme was the analysis of myths in their local contexts, in cooperation with my colleague Minneke Schipper from Leiden University. And upon my arrival in Leiden, which had a special attention on women's studies, I joined in with an analysis of the female perspective in Mentawai narratives. This proved to be a surprisingly revealing approach. During my various visits, I had collected many myths on the tape recorder. And once my assistant and friend Tingatiti came to me and said, "It is funny that you always collected these stories told by men." I happen to know from my mother that women also have stories, and we men actually don't know these, but they are told among themselves, and perhaps it would be interesting to record these as well. "I have an aunt," he said, "who is very good at storytelling, and perhaps we can visit her and ask her to tell us stories." So with our heavy Uher recorders, we went through the forest and arrived at the hut where Tengatiti's aunt lived and asked her to tell a story. And she said, "I don't know any stories," and began to laugh. And then I said, "Yes, but I have here something which make that your voice can be heard back." And I told myself a little story and recorded it. And she heard this and said, "Okay, I want to hear my own voice too." And said some sentences. And then suddenly she said, "Here are my two nieces, and I'm going to tell them a story, and you can record that." So she turned towards her two nieces and began to tell them a story without interruption for quarters and quarters of hours. And the nieces were hearing and laughing, and I didn't understand very much what it was about. But when hearing it back, I realized that many of these stories I had always recorded earlier in their male versions, and that these female versions were indeed very funnily different from what I had recorded in many details, and sometimes they even seemed reversed. And then in the evening, the aunt came back to my house where I lived there. That was not among the Sakude, but among the group where this friend Tengatiti, this assistant, came from, another village. And here we were sitting with other men of the village. And she said, "I have more stories I can tell you." And now the funny situation arose that men came to listen to stories women tell, which they didn't even know that they existed. And they also began to wonder and said, "It's funny, it's our stories, but they are different." And these differences showed that in certain instances, the view of the women on Mentawai conditions were fundamentally different from the male equivalents. Striking were the mystical perceptions of the matrimonial alliances. In the view of the men, the giving away of a sister was pivotal in their efforts to create a harmonious relationship with neighbors and to have a reliable bond with these groups. But as we all have seen in the repercussions the relation to neighbors has found in the ritual, these relations were not trusted. They were not seen as something really reliable. The stories always get a twist, conflicts arose, and in the end, the man rested alone, that we say together with his patrilineal group, in his longhouse, and lived there in seclusion. In the female versions, on the other hand, the results seem to be turned around. Here, the protagonists saw themselves not as passive pieces brought into play by their fathers or brothers in an exchange transaction with dubitable effects, but they saw themselves as active agents who brought communities together and who, together with their offspring, created peaceful continuity. So these female stories end with happy groups of people visiting each other, sharing experiences, and having children playing in the surroundings. None of these divergent results mirrors reality, of course. Conflicts remain, and marital bonds can strand. But for an understanding of the feelings people have, this approach in otherwise latent expressions, which would never be worded directly, by the women as their own experience is certainly revealing. And I still have a whole, corpus of Mentawai myths, including many songs, waiting for an interpretation. They manifest amazing creativity of human imagination, something perhaps for coming years. Soon after my start in Leiden, a grant by the Dutch Academy of Arts and Sciences opened up the possibility to embark on a more systematic program intended to document the Indonesian interpret design and meaning of Western Indonesian traditional architecture. In this program, many earlier interests came together. Art, symbolism, and the potentialities of comparison within the field of study. Indeed, it appeared that when comparing architectural forms, in many instances, one couldn't really understand how they were constructed without having a look at similar constructions in other regions where they had a more logical composition. My friend architect who was participating in that project, he came time and again and said, "This is very crazy how people do this. It could be much be done much more efficient." And then it came out that the reason why they did it in such a inefficient way had always to do with a kind of thinking. They wanted to express something with this specific execution of, let's say, a combination of woods or something like that. The results were presented in exhibitions and in different volumes. I have here two Indonesian houses, one and two, which have contributions by many different anthropologists giving their interpretation of the architecture they encountered in their regions of study. A side effect of this was a reader compelled together with Hans van Mölle. Now we need still another book, and which is Treasure Hunting. Yeah, the last one. This was a side effect of this interest going to material culture. We asked ourselves, what were the motives of the collectors who were the founders of the Indonesian collections in the various Western museums, and what brought them to embarking on often quite dangerous and difficult travels to faraway places. What came out was that personal profit, which perhaps one would expect in the first place, was certainly not the most important motive. Much more important was the scientific or public renown people would get by this collecting, and in some instances also sheer poor romanticism, and even combined with a wish to withdraw from the Western world, as I myself had experienced with Paul Wirtz in Basel, who had been in New Guinea and then lived far away from the town in a house with a secret garden where lots of stories were ranked around about strange things he did there, but nobody knew exactly what it was. Personal profit, however, came more and more to the fore in the increasing incidence of fake production of indigenous art in the last decennia. The danger of this appeared not only in the criminal making of money, but also in the distortions the fakes meant for the stylistic canon of the people in question. As they were often manipulated in order to please the eyes of potential Western buyers. I was confronted with this criminal field by the publication in 1999 of some Mentawai artifacts, which in my view were not of local origin, but which were not simple patinated copies of material already known from old collections either. In a publication of the Geneva Museum for Non-Western Art, I discovered a carving that I had photographed years ago in that is here at the left, in the house of a friend in the interior of Siberut, who had built this house, this one, as a shelter for potential tourists. He would hope that in the long run, tourists would come even to the interior of Siberut, and that he would get some income from that. So he decorated the house with reliefs like we see here. But obviously his dreams did not come true, because soon afterwards this appeared in a museum, and it's exactly that. So obviously a buyer had come to this remote place and had bought the relief, but in order to make it more attractive and more mystical, he had patinated it and added little monkey skulls so that it looks like a cult object. So this kind of things, of course, are a very dangerous development, and I found it more and more in later years, when the art market just couldn't find any original pieces anymore on Siberut. The detrimental policies of the government had effect that most of this traditional art had vanished. So the art traders were forced to make these things themselves, and I found in Bali three shops, art shops called Mentawai 1, Mentawai 2, and Mentawai 3, all selling Mentawai artifacts, which when you turned around and were looking in the courtyard behind, you saw them being manufactured on the spot. Now, this development also brought me to think more about the own aesthetic principles of the Mentawais. What was their idea about how an aesthetically made product should look like? They had no words for art, but when I asked them who were the most gifted carvers, they always mentioned at once concrete individuals. A first requirement for a positive judgment was always that it should be made technically perfect. Moreover, it should harmoniously fit into the place where it was to come. Again, this idea that you have to be in a harmonious relationship with your surrounding. So a beautiful bird which is too big would not be estimated because it detonated in its surroundings. That was something they directly quoted. And then the last thing they said, they had a word for, that was that a design should be in maximum accordance with traditional models. For these designs, they claimed a realistic ideal. The same realistic ideal they had also when they looked at my books they had brought when there were pictures of Western art they admired most, which was very realistic, and the other things they saw they were not very good in their techniques. And this ideal, of course, was an evident contrast with their own makings. I was always intrigued by the way they shaped a deer when they had shot a deer. Sometimes they draw it on the wall, and they draw it always with the depicted it always with the knee joint of the hind leg in here it is. Here you see the deer with the knee joint of the hind leg pointing forwards like in a human being. So I was astonished to see that. I thought that deer in our country are very different. They were very astonished to hear that, that all deer in Mentawai are constructed like we paint them. And then soon afterwards, a deer was shot, and of course, I hastened myself to point to the differences. And the whole group came together and was very much wondering that a joint should be different from like they used to paint it. And they accepted this as a fact. And then they dropped it again. And when I came back at a later time, that new made new drawings of deer always with the knees pointing forward, the joints of the knees pointing forwards, as if the visual, the imagined reality was much more superior to the sheer realism of daily life. In the book Toys for the Souls, which I already have shown, I have dealt with all aspects of my Mentawai art. I regard this book that owes much to the help of Jet Barkels and Stephen Alpert, also as an appeal to a broader public to get aware of the rich creativity in Indonesian tribal traditions. Stephen Alpert is a friend of mine from Dallas, and we have edited together a book on tribal Indonesian art, this one, which covers the whole archipelago and has beautiful illustrations and descriptions of the art by various competent anthropologists. It is an appeal to a broader public to get aware of the rich creativity in Indonesian tribal traditions, and is complemented by a website that is in wording and which is supposed to make the results accessible also to young Mantaveans. Young Mantaveans today have often accessible to internet, and after that, the fact that their old traditional art actually is not existent on the island anymore, there is much interest among them to see what testimonies of their own heritage, which they can take as guidelines for own new production. And this new production coming on, not to make fakes, but to make toys for the souls in modern guise, which is very gladly relying on examples from their former heritage. And after so much testimonies of Indonesian tribal heritage have violently been destroyed, I hope this book can also contribute as a reminder of the responsibility we anthropologists have in assisting small-scale societies in the face, in the attempts to find their own ways in the face of overwhelming modernization.